So this is kind of a unique opportunity that we had such a large class and we wanted to kind of kick these off. As you all very well know, we last semester launched MyCJC for students on Twitter and just trying to get you guys some more information. So we decided to start these MyCJC speaker series. And we're going to record these and put these up on MyCJC for students that couldn't make it today. But we have two very distinguished professors here at the College of Journalism and Communications. Professor Lewis, as I like to call my guy on the shoulder on this side that tells me all the good things that I should do. And he is an expert on ethics. He also teaches the lovely grammar class that some of you have had to go through in this program. And Professor Calvert, one of the foremost experts on the First Amendment with over 115 law journal articles about the First Amendment, points that the Gators wish they scored that much this season. So, we're going to start off. Professor Lewis, Professor Calvert.
All right, well, let's start with the First Amendment, which protects freedom of speech from government censorship in the United States, not private censorship. So if Walmart didn't want to sell your CD for some reason that you produced or the video game that you created, there is no First Amendment violation. So the First Amendment only protects us against, essentially, government censorship of our speech. Basically, today, what I'm going to be doing is running through a list of hot topics and problems involving social media and the law today, as it affects not only journalists, members of the press, but people more generally. And the big picture, I guess, the overall observation I would make is this, that just because things like Twitter and Facebook are relatively new forms of media, it does not exempt them from generally applicable laws that have existed for decades and decades in the United States. Essentially, it's just like new wine being poured into old bottles. And we're trying to sort out the shape of those bottles a little bit here and there, but generally the same rules apply. So the very first thing I want to talk about is defamation. Defamation is essentially a false statement of fact that harms somebody's reputation. And the question comes up, can you be held liable civilly for something that you tweet about somebody else that turns out to be false and would harm their reputation? And the answer to that is yes. So even though there may only be 140 characters, and even though you might try to remove the tweet or pull it down or retract it later on, once it's disseminated out there, indeed there could be an action, a civil action for defamation. The leading case on this involves Courtney Love, or as the case actually refers to her real name, Courtney Michelle Love, which I didn't know either. Many of you know her simply as the widow Cobain, is the other way I like to think of Courtney Love. Some of you, how many of you actually seen The People versus Larry Flint? Anybody seen that movie? A few of you have. As you know, she played Althea, Larry Flint's wife. It was a tough role for her, playing a drug-addled stripper. Anyway, what happened in this, she's not going to sue me. Courtney Love is the defendant in this defamation action. She goes online and she posts some very harsh remarks on her tweet, on Twitter actually, so she tweets these remarks about somebody, another woman who operates the Boudoir Queen site. And essentially, the target that Courtney Love tweets about sues her for defamation. The long and short of this is that the case settles for $430,000 on the defamation cause of action. So very important to understand that you can be held liable for saying something false and defamatory in a tweet, even though it may be very brief. And Courtney Love had to settle that case for $430,000 because of these comments she was posting about some fashion designer online. The second one I want to point out go back to the bottom part, retweeting defamatory comments made by others. This is very important, that just because somebody else says it, you receive a tweet from somebody and it says something that, you know, is defamatory and false, but you think it's pretty cool, and you send it out to someone else, you retweet that, you could be held liable for that just as if you had created that message yourself. And this is one of the big things that most people don't understand. Just because someone else said it and you accurately attribute it to them does not get you off the hook. Does not get you off the hook. So this is very much a danger. Somebody says something scandalous about somebody, you receive it, think before you retweet that out to somebody else. That's the same thing in journalism, to give you an example. Somebody, you run a letter to the editor in the Gainesville Sun, says something false and defamatory in the letter to the Gainesville Sun. The Gainesville Sun cannot say, it's a letter to the editor, we didn't write it. The Gainesville Sun would be held responsible just as if it had created that letter itself. So defamation is the big first thing. Beware of that, what you post, what you tweet. The second topic, if we can move forward to this, invasion of privacy and wiretapping. Here's something that comes up. You've got a smartphone and you're eavesdropping on somebody and you take pictures of them when they are in a private place where they don't know you're around, or you're recording their conversation. And they may be in an they may have a reasonable expectation of privacy in the location. This would not be something outside in public. But imagine it's in a location which is a closed room, and you happen to use your smartphone or other kind of technology to record what's going on. All states have wiretapping laws, which again would prevent the recording of conversations where somebody has a quote reasonable expectation of privacy in that conversation. So be aware of that. The other thing today, I was thinking about how many of you read the Alligator today about the UF boobs site. Did anybody see this site? Yes, very good. Now those people who voluntarily send in those pictures obviously have no expectation of privacy. But imagine that somebody was doing this nefariously. Girls with cleavage just taking their little smartphone around campus, posting pictures up there. Think about the potential, though, for causes of action that that person might have against you if you were to take those photographs or images. What happens, bullet point number two, if you disclose the content of those private conversations? So suppose somebody does have a reasonable expectation of privacy in the conversation. They're saying something that's inherently private and would be embarrassing to them if it were released. You might be held liable for that when you release that, so beware of that. And finally, this last one is a very interesting thing which is happening more and more to journalists. People using their smartphones to record the police when they pull somebody over or stop someone to interrogate them. So the police have pulled somebody over at a stop, or they're investigating someone in downtown Gainesville. You get your smartphone out and you start recording that. Can you do that? We would typically think the answer would be obviously yes. You're in a public place. The officers have no reasonable expectation of privacy in doing that. But it ties back into that first part about the recording of conversations. And some states have laws against that. The good news is that the courts now are making it clear that yes, you do have the right to record the police performing their jobs as long as you're not obstructing with them doing that. And that's important to understand. A case came out of Boston standing for that. Somebody recorded somebody in Boston Common as the officer was arresting somebody else. And they said if you're in a public place, you've got a right to record it as long as you're not interfering with them performing their jobs. Let's move on to the next topic, which would be interesting. Intellectual property rights and copyright. Who owns photos that are tweeted and retweeted is an interesting issue. A case just came down, actually this past week, and I'll read it to you. It says, news outlets improperly used photos posted to Twitter, according to a judge. Just read you the first two sentences of this. It says, a judge has found that two news organizations improperly used images that a photojournalist had posted to Twitter in one of the first big tests of intellectual property law involving social media. The French press agency and the Washington Post infringed on the copyrights of the photographer in using the pictures he took in the aftermath of the Haiti earthquake. So essentially, he, using Twitter, the photographer, puts these pictures out there. The press agency grabs them and essentially then sells them commercially to other news media outlets. Now, even though the terms of use might say that if you post something on Facebook, others may be able to use it, they did not go so far as to create a license, and that's what the judge says. And that's essentially what this photographer would have demanded, giving a license to a press agency to use them, because he would still control ownership. So be very careful about them. License agreements for content recorded on smartphones, another big issue. You happen on your smartphone to record a car accident or the aftermath of it, or you're recording some other news event, and then you say, hey, I want to get it on TV, so I'm going to give this to CNN, or I'm going to give it to Fox News or the local station. Be very careful when you do that. What rights are you giving them? Are you giving it to everybody in all the world just to CNN to use online, on television? Ideally, when you specify that, you want to actually have your own kind of a license agreement and get some cash for that up front. Very important. Otherwise, if you give it to CNN free, they're going to use it and it could end up, and it could be a very famous tape that you made. You never know. It could be the Rodney King beatings and everybody wants to have that, and don't you want to own that? So you can get some money from that. So be very careful when you give it to the news media for that. fair use defense for taking photographs from Facebook. So imagine that it happens all the time. There's a news story in town, a crime in town, a child is hurt, and so in order to find a picture of the child, they go to the kid's Facebook account, and they download the news organization, Channel 20, takes that kid's picture from Facebook and uses it on the news. Now, if you look at Facebook's terms of use, which is always the key thing that you want to do, it does give Facebook a co-license, essentially, to use things that you post, intellectual property, and it says that others can use them. I think that if you're using someone's photograph for a newsworthy purpose, you're probably going to be protected by a fair use defense. But that's a gray area. Sponsored stories. How many of you have ever seen this on Facebook? Sponsored stories. Somebody likes something and their image just pops up. You know what I'm talking about on Facebook? Okay, basically, Facebook has just settled a massive settlement with the FTC for that. People said, hey, I didn't give consent for my image to pop up next to this product. Essentially, you're marketing me. If you've ever appeared on a Facebook-sponsored story where your image has appeared on somebody else's page liking something, you're probably going to get a small settlement of $10. But you will be able to get it, so go to the FTC's trademark. So what I'm talking about there is misappropriation of somebody's image. Go to the next one, I'll hit number four. Anonymity online. Your identity is discoverable. Suppose that you anonymously post something on the internet, or you tweet something ostensibly anonymously, and that something you tweet or post has something defamatory on it. Can the person about whom you're saying something defamatory discover your identity even though you purport to be anonymous? And the answer to that is yes. They certainly can do that. And more courts are finding that. The individual who claims he's defamed will have to go to court and try to make a good faith showing that indeed I've got a valid cause of action. So again, even though you think you're anonymous online, if you defame somebody, that somebody can go to the ISP, the interactive service, or the online service provider, or the interactive computer service and say, hey, here's my subpoena, reveal that person's identity, their account number, I want to sue them, and indeed they can do that. So when you think you're anonymous online, you're not always. And last but not least, interesting issues are coming up, tweeting from courts. Many judges now allow this. Live tweeting if you're a reporter from a court. The rules will vary from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. But recently, the second point came up, and I'll just read you this article. It says, reporter's tweeted photo of juror leads judge to declare mistrial in murder prosecution. And here's what it says. A Kansas judge declared a mistrial in a murder case after a reporter tweeted a photograph containing the profile of a juror. Topeka Capital Journal reporter Anne Marie Bush live tweeted the opening day of the trial, and she was allowed to do that. But what she wasn't allowed to do was to take a photograph of a juror, and many courts have rules like that. And when she sent that out, what happened? They had to declare an entire mistrial in that case. And I love the response from the newspaper. The Capital Journal regrets the error and the loss of the court's time. We'll use this as a training opportunity for our staff members as they strive to bring information to our readers in digital and print media. So basically, as you can see, there are multiple issues that are going around in the area of social media and the law. These are just some of them. And so I'll take questions that people have them fire away on any of these topics. Yes?
With the Larry Flint case, he was able to get away with whatever. I can't remember exactly what's going on, but with whatever he said about the pastor. Why was it that Courtney Love wasn't able to...
Okay, very good. Because the Hustler versus Falwell case dealt with an ad parody, which was not an assertion of fact. So libel law deals with false statements of fact. So what Courtney Love was posting about this individual who sued her were actually false assertions of fact. If that makes any sense to you. Things that are verifiable as provable true or false. Yes?
What about the tweet opinion? You start with I think, or you say.
Okay. Opinions generally are protected, but that's what we call bootstrapping. You cannot label something an opinion and turn it into an opinion. So that would be, I believe that Professor Foley, in my opinion, Professor Foley stole money from the College of Journalism's travel budget, okay? Now, that's a false factual assertion, isn't it? It's a false factual assertion because there's money, I'm saying this about him, we can find it out, we can look at his new Lambo that he's got parked out back, or was it a Bentley, I forget, and his checking account, and obviously his upscale fashion attire. So we could find, that's not a guy, or, okay, anyway, the shirts, I'm just looking. So anyway, we could find that out. So merely labeling, in my opinion, doesn't get you there. The key thing for this, what's fact versus opinion, is it provable or verifiable as false? If you said that the play calling at the Sugar Bowl was the worst I've ever seen, that's your opinion and you're protected, isn't it? Because we can't prove that true or false. If you said that a player uses illegal steroids on the football team, that's a false factual assertion. Clay Calvert's the worst professor I've ever had, that's your opinion, you can say it. But if you start going into stealing money from the travel budget, that's verifiable. So that's a quick and dirty answer for that. Other questions that you might have about any of these various issues? Yes. No, it should not change at all. As long as you're in a public place where you have a right to be. Now, what will happen is cops don't like this very much because you're recording them what they're doing. And this is why these cases have come up. The police have been arresting people doing this. And then they'll cite a law about recording of conversations, as we were talking about. But what the courts are saying that they're a public official performing a public duty in a public place, you have the right to do that. And so indeed, let's say you take the picture and then you want to sell it then to the Gainesville Sun because the Gainesville Sun didn't have a photographer out there taking the picture to go with the story, then that's where the licensing part comes up, where you should make it clear, and you should also make it clear, are you allowing it only in the print edition? Are you allowing it in the online edition? And then, are you allowing it to be indexed in Newsbank or LexisNexis or an online database? Because initially, some of these photographers and writers, the initial agreement only covered for their use in the hard newspaper. Then it went online, and then the newspaper articles went in an electronic database. So you can specify all those terms, what you're giving away in that. So you would, yes?
For the incident with Mitt Romney and the hidden camera of the 47% comments, was the person who set up the hidden camera, is he breaking any laws in regards to invasion of privacy?
Okay, as long as the person had a legitimate right to be in the location,
okay,
they generally could do that. Now, that it's a good question. Clearly, there are so many people, and it's not a private conversation. Imagine it was just Romney one-on-one with one person saying this, and the other person was hiding behind something. Then that's where you would have the typical wiretap kind of a problem in this thing. I think that's one of the things that public officials, and it happens in other contexts, they go into expecting a friendly environment, and that's where social media have made a game-changing difference, in those things. Somebody over here had a, yes?
Today in my investigative reporting class, we watched videos of Chris Hansen from a Dateline NBC segment where he found people that were selling illegal things on the internet, and then he confronted them on camera. But there was one segment where he went into a mall that was, there was a kiosk that was apparently selling knockoff phone cases. And the man that was working at the kiosk pushed him out of, didn't really push him, but was trying to get him out of the space, basically. And Chris Hansen is all smug because he's in the sea and he wasn't really moving. And then, but the fact that he was in the mall, which is private property, but still a public place, how would that be? Because the man kept saying, get the camera out of my face. Is that okay?
It's a good question. Malls are generally private. California had some court decisions saying that malls are public fora today because people do that. But generally a mall can create its own rules, and they generally have them, don't they? About offensive language on shirts,
yeah.
Noise, things like that. And so it would all depend upon that type of a situation. What were the rules that the mall itself created? That would generally be how I'd have first approached it. Obviously, if he pushes him, that's a possible assault charge against him for pushing him whether he likes him or not. Chris Hansen, of course, is the one from To Catch a Predator series when they crossed the line on that, and they were found liable for basically creating the news when they went to a suspect's house and then the suspect killed himself, which is a pretty famous case. And the judge said, no, NBC, you're now making the news. You rounded up the law enforcement officials. You went over to his house. So he's kind of shady in many ways. Other questions? Somebody else? anything that you can do. Yes.
Are there legal concerns with publishing tweets or publishing comments on Facebook pages?
Sure. I mean, yeah, and that's the thing, too, is it could be something that's copyrighted. I mean, you can think about it. Anything that you write, really, you would control a copyright to, even though you've not registered it in some way. And then it's really the commercial exploitation, because, and that's what the judge said in this case when I was talking about the photographs. And the judge makes this point. I'll just read it to you. It says the court need not fix the precise scope of any license created by Twitter's terms of service in order to resolve the dispute. Rather, it suffices to say that based on the evidence presented to the court, the Twitter terms of service do not provide the French press agency with an excuse for its conduct in this particular case. And they say, yeah, sure, you can send it on to somebody else, but when you're using it for a commercial purpose and profiting from it, essentially, which is what the press agencies were doing, that's where they got into trouble, I believe is what the court says. The evidence does not reflect a clear intent to grant the French press agency a license to use these. It fails to recognize, and this is the key thing, even if some reuses of content posted on Twitter may be permissible, does not necessarily require a general license to use the content. So I think when you start making money off of somebody else's content that they posted, that's a danger. The other danger, too, I'm not going to go into much, is endorsements. Somebody likes your product, a celebrity likes your product, and they tweet about it, and now you want to use that tweet in your advertising. So that's where you need that celebrity's permission to do that. You definitely need to get their permission to use that. That would be like any other celebrity. So you create a product, some celebrity tweets about it, it's very cool, and you say, oh, that's great, I'm going to put that on my website now because the celebrity liked it. You better get that celebrity's permission before you do that, because it implies that he actually or she endorses it. Yes?
I was just waiting on a scene once, and there was someone getting loaded into an ambulance. And so there was me and my photographer, I was trying to report on it.
Your photographer? Yeah, okay, go ahead.
It was on the sidewalk, and I was waiting until the photographer, was doing his thing. I was waiting for the cop was ready to speak with me, and he started kind of shooing in the photographer way, saying, this is violating HIPAA laws.
That is not a HIPAA law violation. No, that is incorrect on that part. Yeah, if you're in a public place, you've got the right to shoot it, and they will push you back, which is very common as far as they go. And so you kind of have to put up with that behind the yellow tape thing. And that's the strategy. They'll push you so far back you can't get the shot. But that is not a HIPAA violation. Take a photograph out there. That's what they were saying.
Right.
No.
You're just being reporting on it at all.
No. Then we wouldn't be able to report on any medical injuries, traffic accidents,
exactly.
Just by extension. So no, you were in the right, but what you experienced was common, I would say. Yes.
For example, with Instagram, now there's this whole clause that if somebody wanted to use a photo that I've taken of their business for advertisement, they don't need to ask my permission, or what's the deal with that? Do they need to obtain a license from me?
Well, again, and this is part one of the problems that are being sorted out, because people are basically giving away a lot of their rights. And part of the question, I guess, would be the when you sign essentially what amounts to almost an adhesion contract, because you don't have the ability to go and negotiate that with people from Instagram. It's like buying a parking ticket. When you go into a parking space at the airport, you can't take that parking ticket, which on the backside relieves the airport of all liability, and you can't go talk to the woman in the office and say, I'd like to negotiate the terms at the back of my parking ticket. So it's very much like that, and courts are going to be sorting that out. And I think also the thing is, the Federal Trade Commission, is increasingly cracking down on Google and Facebook and privacy concerns. It's going to take somebody like that to get involved. Yes, the terms of service, the terms of use are generally binding on these things. So you got to be very careful about what you choose to post. And so that's why when people say, we're no longer going to use your service, that's what they're talking about, I think. Others who have not asked.
One more, and then we'll wrap up and move ahead.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
If a social media site like Instagram or Facebook uses a photo posted on their site by an individual, as they have every right to, and there's something wrong with the photo, whether it's falsified or there's something illegal in it, could legal ramifications fall back on the individual who originally posted the photo, or would it be the company that made the photo public?
It could be both, actually. It could be both. Both could face liability for that. Generally, though, there is, and this is interesting, there is an exemption for internet service providers and interactive computer services for third-party content created by others. But in your scenario, Instagram is taking the photo itself, right, and publishing it itself, in addition to the person who posted it. So both could be held liable. The situation I was describing about the exemption is, imagines the Gainesville Sun and people post a bunch of comments afterwards, the story, you know how people always do that? They're very professional comments, obviously. But people always tend to say defamatory things about other people. Is the Gainesville Sun liable for those comments? The answer to that is no. Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act gives them immunity because they're created by somebody else. The Gainesville Sun can do a takedown, they can remove them, they can monitor them, but as long as they don't create them and solicit defamatory content, they're going to be protected in that situation. So that's kind of an overview, and we'll come back.
I want to congratulate all of you. You've just heard that Professor Foley came across an extra stash of cash here recently. Being a guy who loves journalism and public service, he has decided to start an online-only news site called HogtownNews.com. Hogtown being a play off of Hogtown Creek, sometimes a derisive moniker given to the fair city in which we all reside. So everybody, thank you, Professor Foley, for providing all of you jobs. Huh? You are all now working at HogtownNews.com. Congratulations. Wednesday of last week, you discovered that there's a missing person on campus. She's a graduate student in the pharmacy department. She is pretty well known within the pharmacy department. She's a very promising scholar, and her disappearance stirs some concern. We don't know if she just walked off on her own or what's happened. Well, on Friday, you get news from the police that they're suspicious. They think some foul play has befallen this graduate student. So you report that on Friday on HogtownNews.com, okay? On Saturday, you discover that the police have found that there is a stash of bloody clothes found above the ceiling tiles in the pharmacy lab. And those clothes appear to belong to the missing student. So you write that up on HogtownNews.com. On Sunday, her body is discovered inside a wall near the pharmacy lab. And it's indeed the missing student. So you write that up, unfortunate news. On Monday, the police tell you at the end of the day that they have a prime suspect, and they give you the identity of that person. And it's now Tuesday today, and you try searching anything you can to find out about this suspect. You have good sources in the police department. You've been well trained by Professor Foley. You know how to build sources well, and you discover through your sources that the prime suspect had been named in a police report 6 years ago. And in that police report 6 years ago, filed by the person who was then his girlfriend, they were both in high school at the time, here in Gainesville, she filed a complaint saying that he had been abusive toward her. She had been trying to break up with him. He responded somewhat violently by sort of shoving her locker and writing derogatory things on it. And then later she told the police he went over to see her and forced her to have sex with him. She told police she didn't want to file any complaint, but a counselor at the school found out about it, called the police, and that's how the report got filed. So you now know about the prime suspect that the police have identified. You know that 6 years ago he was involved in this incident involving what appears to be some kind of abuse toward the girlfriend at the time. So you'd like to know more about the suspect. Now the suspect's been arrested and he's in jail, so obviously he's not talking. So you do a little digging and you find out that the person who was his girlfriend at the time has a Facebook account. Her Facebook account is set to private, meaning that you have to be one of her friends to find out what she's written about. Now, as an enterprising journalist, you know the chances that she's going to consent to an interview with you. If you say, hi, I'm so-and-so with HogtownNews.com, are pretty much slim and none, right? This is a big murder case. It suddenly attracted a whole lot of attention. For it turns out that this unfortunate person who died was to have been married herself on Sunday. Turns out that she's also a very attractive and capable young woman, and she has attracted attention from news media all over the Southeast, and even the New York Times is interested. So you have a big story. You're trying to preserve your scoop here in Gainesville for HogtownNews.com. You don't want to disappoint Professor Foley, but she's not going to talk to you, okay? Question. Do you send her a Facebook friend request so you can see what she's had on her Facebook postings and see if there's information that might reveal something about the prime suspect who she used to know? Okay? Are you going to send a Facebook friend request without identifying yourself? Just use your name, but not say what purpose. Would you do that? This is now the interactive portion of our program.
Yeah, I would, because my profile says that I'm
alive,
and I'm a reporter, and I think I would follow it up with a message notifying her that I am a reporter, but ultimately it's up to her whether or not to let me access to
your profile. Okay, why is it up to her to decide whether to give access to your profile?
She has to accept my request.
She has to accept your request. Have you ever gotten friend requests from people you really can barely remember? Are you inclined to sort of,
deny them? Yes.
Maybe sometimes you deny, sometimes you say yes?
Is it worth taking the risk of, I mean, like, I would rather send a request and have her deny it than never accept a request at all.
Okay, but are you going to send her as Julia Glum, Hogtown News, or are you just gonna give your name?
I don't understand.
If you identify yourself as a journalist, she's probably gonna say no. She doesn't want to get messed up in all this. But would you withhold your identity as a journalist?
You can't withhold your identity on Facebook.
Yes, you could just be yourself. I mean, you whatever you've got on your Facebook profile is what's ever there. But you don't have to be prominent. So you would, Chris?
I thought she was going to argue against that. I think you have an obligation to at least let them know who you are. If you try to just phone her and play that way, that's inevitably going to turn against you in that press. She's probably going to get upset. She's probably going to contact editors. Other journalists might decide to write a story about that. It just seems like that's everything that we've been taught, especially from Professor Foley and other people, say that you always identify yourself as a journalist.
You agree?
I would think about the ethical implications first and foremost, like how could this blow up and the worst of the worst. I wouldn't, period. I wouldn't add her on Facebook, even if I were to not represent myself as who I am, which is ethically wrong. But because anything that she would have to say about this, you know, the suspect is not in any way relating to this particular case that I'm writing about. So really anything she says isn't really worth a while, maybe to get an insight to maybe who he is. But it's not really in relation to this particular case.
Okay, but there's lots of journalists chasing this story, and Professor Foley wants you to stay ahead of it. And it's now 3:35 in the afternoon. We need something.
I would add her, and if she accepts, I wouldn't say I'm a reporter, just to get background information, just to get a feel for the story, feel for what I'm entering. And if she accepts, then she's accepting me as like a Facebook. But would I use what she's saying as a reporter? Then I would tell her what I've seen. I'm a reporter and I've seen this. I'm going to use it for my own consent. But as a person just trying to, I guess, acclimate myself with her story, I would just ask her.
All right. So you're going to add her without identifying yourself, so you can peek behind the curtain. But you're not going to use anything until you check with her. Is that what
yes.
I'm hearing? Okay. Who else? You want to identify your journalistic purpose, okay?
How exactly is it that you're supposed to identify yourself? Because there are some people who, you can't even send them a message if you're not their friend.
So in this case, you're sending the friend request. I'd like to.
Just your name.
It's just your name.
But you also have.
It's your whole Facebook profile there.
Right.
Whatever you put on your Facebook page is there.
I kind of disagree with the whole mood in the room with this, because I feel like I would like look at mutual friends and see if any of my friends were friends with her and ask them to log in for me to look at her account. I'm willing to do like anything that takes the information about such a high profile case just to raise the profile of my own media organization. Because I mean, there's journalism, but you have to like have people read what you're writing. And if you're, this is a big story, you want to do anything it takes to get the information.
The big story, and you want this story, okay? So you go through your list of mutual friends, you don't find anybody, okay? Do you send her the request?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. And why?
Because this is her profile, and I think that in the same way you can look up a public record about somebody and not have them know you're looking up that record, this is kind of the same thing. Like, even though it's not, Facebook's not public and her information's not public, you have the ability to garner that information public, then you will be able to be.
All right, so you're raising the first really important question that everybody has to consider with things like Facebook and Twitter, et cetera, right? There's a legal standard for what's private, but there's the common understood right, of standard of what private is. Is somebody's Facebook material private? If they put it behind a wall that you have to friend them to get it, is it still private? See, you've got a meaning. Stephanie.
I think it also depends too, because like, this is a high-profile case, so I'm going to assume that every other reporter on the case is also friend requesting her. So I think if she doesn't figure out that, you know, the reason she has 20 friend requests at once is because she's dating the guy that's in jail, then, I still think that you should identify yourself, but I also think that's, like, partly on her, too.
All right, so you raise a really good point. Is that her obligation, and is everyone else friending her? Now let's add to the story. Because, in fact, you're a very smart cookie. You've been very well trained by Professor Foley, and all those other journalists haven't thought that fast. Nobody else has sent her a friend request. Nobody went through and found the information in the police records to connect her to the case and thought to ask her. So, in fact, you're the only one. So she has no reason to suspect that there's a whole bunch of people trying to friend request her because no one else has. Does that change anything for you?
I think so. I think I would feel more obligated to identify myself than if I didn't think a lot of people were requesting her.
So the degree to which you self-identify your profession is relative.
If it's not, like if my profession is posted on my Facebook, which on my Facebook, but if I have that I'm a reporter at the Hogtown newspaper and it's on my Facebook, then I think that they're going to find out anyway. But I think if it's private, then yeah, I think it's relevant.
So it may depend upon the level to which you've self-disclosed. Okay, good point. Somebody over here, yes?
Going off what she was saying, like within like even Twitter and Facebook, like you can have a private page or a public page. And although people think that making your page private makes your information private and people can't use it, it is still like a public website in general. So any information found on there or put up on there, you kind of lose a little bit of your privacy because you made the choice to publish it.
Even if you say this is my private stuff and you can only see it if I let you in?
Even when you're signing up, you kind of know, yeah, this is a shared space, and like even though I settings to only allow a certain amount of people to see it, it's still up on this website. That's why Instagram, like the whole case of them using their pictures for any purpose or whatever, they still have a right, because you, with your own choice, sign up for the website, you sign up to join it, you're posting what you want, you're publishing the photos you want on there. So
in your view, once you sign on to Facebook, even if you got private settings, you got to accept the fact that it's out there. Okay.
I would say that depending on how the person themselves uses their own Facebook will be dependent on whether they will accept some person, whether it says their profession is journalism or not. It is the way they use their Facebook that will affect that. if they put up a private barrier saying, I need to accept you before we communicate information, that doesn't mean that they might necessarily not have 3,000 Facebook friends that they don't talk to every day, and all that information is just being sent out. So I think it's a difference for the people that have, let's say, 500, 600 people, that they could literally go up to them and talk to them at any point. Whereas the people that may have more friends may be open, whether they have that private barrier or not, to accept people that they don't necessarily talk to on an everyday basis.
So you're saying the decision you make as a journalist may depend upon how many friends that person has?
It may depend upon if they use their Facebook for their group of friends or for their group of friends, acquaintances, and every single person that they meet.
And how do you know how wide that is when all that's private? You're raising a good question, but you don't know all that yet, right? Because you're sort of hidden. You know how many friends. We don't know who they are. Somebody here had? Oh, yeah.
Kind of similar to what she was saying, but I thought Facebook was pretty clear that you're allowed to use their space, but most of what you put up there belongs to Facebook.
So Facebook is very clear from a legal standpoint, right, Professor Kelver? Facebook wants to own everything you do, right, and own it for commercial purposes.
It has it. You create essentially, if you look at the terms, you grant us a non-exclusive, transferable, sub-licensable, royalty-free, worldwide license to use any IP content that you post or in connection with Facebook.
So technically, Facebook owns everything, right?
And Facebook is privately or publicly traded now?
It is now publicly traded, that's right.
It's up to 30 now, the public.
So we have the legal standing that Facebook owns everything on Earth, basically. But we also have the sort of reasonable privacy expectation. It isn't really legal as much as it is ethical, right? Do you sort of think that's your private stuff?
Another thing is the turnaround. Like, you might have her as a friend, maybe your deadline's at 5 o'clock, but she doesn't log into Facebook till 6 and see that, you know, you wanted to add her. So another thing that you could do is either go online, look at her, see if she has a Twitter. Most, some people's Twitters are private, but their Facebooks maybe.
Right.
So see what other social media networks she's involved in. Also, depending on her own privacy settings, sometimes people have a setting where friends of friends can see your material. So you could then, even if you don't have any mutual friends, as he was suggesting, add somebody else in her friend group. Typically, the people that come up are the ones that, I guess, go to her page first or what have you. So add a friend of hers, and maybe then you can see her.
Maybe then, but then you
just reliable on Facebook.
All right, so you're looking for other ways, but we don't know who those friends are, right? Because that's all private. You check Twitter, good thing. Turns out she doesn't tweet. So now what do we do?
Well, I was going to say, like, obviously the legal point is a bit moot because it's a really an ethical issue and how you handle getting your sources. But the gentleman over there said that you got to do what you have to do for your media agency, and they're going to be upset with you. But I still want to point out that I think they're going to be more upset with you when the story breaks, when she complains to another news organization, this person friended me, got all this information for their news report, and then another news organization runs with that story that this person feels that they've been abused somehow by a media organization. There's going to be fallout from that. I mean, that's not something that's just going to pass by. Everyone's going, okay, that was like a newsy story or whatever. It's something that people are going to sensationalize.
So they might, and then and they might just be jealous because you beat them to it.
Either motivation, either way, your media organization ends up in the news the next day for doing something unethical, and that's bad for everyone in your news organization.
Okay.
And trust, you know, is an issue.
The original police report filed, right?
She didn't want any charges to be brought. She couldn't control whether police reports filed, but she asked for no charges.
Didn't file it, the counselor did?
The counselor called the police, who then filed a report.
Okay. So I think because she obviously at the time didn't want to charge him or do anything about that, and you're already, I'm assuming now that we've done this, I don't know, did we try to contact her as a reporter, or did we go straight to Facebook?
You haven't contacted her as a reporter because you know she's going to say no.
Yeah. So if you know she's going to say no, and you know that at the time she didn't want to make it, obviously, like, she don't want to press charges,
I think we should go after it because she's not a public figure, and it sounds like she, if you're already assuming she's unwilling to give you information, then I think you should ethically treat her Facebook the same way.
Okay, so fair point, except that she's not what you're writing about. What you're trying to find out is something about him, right? And maybe she has information from him, maybe they've Facebook back and forth, we don't know. You don't know that till you find out, right? So, all right, let's do a quick check in the room. How many people are gonna send a Facebook request without identifying yourself as a journalist? Professor Foley's looking to see who he's gonna hire, okay? How many of you say, no, I can't do that? Okay, so we're about half and half. Those of you that have the information, okay, you have Facebook friended her, and she said yes. She apparently didn't check things out very fully. She just said yes. So you check on her Facebook page, and you find out some interesting comments that have gone on in the past 2 days that she's made about him. And remember, you're interested in him, not her. Do you report them? It's now 3:45 and you need a story.
Yeah, if I walked up to her house, knocked on her door, and she let me in and started talking to me, I could report that. What's the difference between me sending her a friend request, her accepting it, and me listening to what she said there?
Ah, so you're looking at a parallel in the actual world that maybe is pretty similar, and yet we all know that she might respond to your knock at the door with something like a 38-odd shotgun, you might no longer exist, right? Whereas virtually, we respond to things differently. Okay, anybody gonna use? You already said you're gonna get this stuff, but you're not gonna use it without checking with it. Still the case?
Yeah, but like the whole point of like what you just saying, if I understand like the recording, it's not the same because when you're interviewing someone, it's good to be foundation of, okay, you understand that this can be used, and that person knows that, okay, what I'm saying, these are words that are being written down. But when someone's writing a Facebook like comment, although you have access to the information as a Facebooker because the privacy has turned to public, it's okay, private information that's been public only on the basis of a friend request, not on the basis of like, you can journal what I'm saying, I don't think you can use that information to report, because that understanding is not.
All right, so fair distinction. Let's do a quick survey of the room now. You have Facebook friended her. You have found out information on her Facebook page that's interesting about this prime murder suspect of this student who has met an unfortunate end. Do you use that information without getting her approval? How many of you say, yes, I'm going to use that information she let me see on Facebook?
I don't care about her approval. I just want to make sure it's really her page.
It's truly her page. It's truly her stuff. This is not an imaginary girlfriend. This really exists. Nothing fake.
Is the information that she posted relevant to the case at all?
It's information she posts that's relevant to the case. How many of you are going to run it? How many of you say, no, I still got to ask her if she, right? Here's the dilemma then, right? What's public? What's private? What do we expect? What are our obligations as a journalist? Quickly, this is a real case, not in Gainesville. This is a real case that really happened in New Haven, Connecticut in 2009. And what I'm describing to you is exactly what the journalist involved at the time did, figuring that it never hurts to try. I might as well see if I can get something. She did and got this great scoop. It wasn't a whole lot of detail, but it was some stuff about this prime suspect. And afterwards, she said, I felt really dirty. I felt like I was invading somebody's privacy. And after she found out I was a journalist, because then she called her and said, would you be willing to talk to me? And she said, what? No. Were you this person who friended me? No. She said she felt sort of dirty, but then she said, look, this was out there. This was real. I didn't make it up. And I got a story to write when I'm competing with others. Those are the kind of conflicts that social media creates that the knock on the door doesn't, right? That's what's different about today's world. So thank you, you've been a great audience. Thanks for letting us come.
There will be a recording on this on MyCGC. In one sentence, both of you, your last word of advice for young communicators in all fields. Professor Calvert.
Be careful with what you post, and be careful with what you repost.
Okay, and Professor Lewis, one word of advice.
Do good.
Thanks guys so much. Have a great day.